As far as my battalion of the Royal Scots Fusiliers is concerned, the battle that burst the Siegfried Line and led to the capture of Cleve was won before it started. We trained and trained and trained in cooperation of arms, and that's how we got through with practically no bother at all. It was all laid on. Every man knew what he had to do and how he was going to do it. As an example, take our rehearsal with flamethrowers. Our flamethrowers would shoot their flame on the ground in front of our troops and they would run through the fire. It was a bit frightening at first, but after we had run through the flames two or three times, we were full of confidence and would run through without hesitation and without harm. Later on, the effect of the flamethrowers on the Germans was seen. I heard one prisoner being asked why he gave himself up. "Why," he said, "the Flammenwerfer only missed me by a yard." However, to go on with my story, as well as training the men in cooperation of weapons, before the operation began, every man was told exactly what was going to happen and when it would happen. He knew exactly his place in the vehicle he was to ride in, where his equipment and weapons would go, even what side of the vehicle he would dismount from, and what he would see and should do when he did dismount. In short, every detail was worked out beforehand, and the men appreciated and took great interest in this briefing. Only two things interfered with these carefully laid plans, the weather and the floods. But we got over that, and whenever a vehicle got ditched or stuck in the mud, the men bailed out and got into another one. The Royal Scots Fusiliers went through on one of the only bits of unflooded ground, a narrow neck between the northern edge of the Reichswald and the completely wet area between the Rhine where the Canadians were paddling about. There was only one road available to us, a narrow third-class road, almost impassable because of the mud. And on this one road, all our fighting and supply vehicles were queued up. Tanks, self-propelled guns, and all the vehicles with the fancy zoological names, such as the Kangaroos, that's the armoured troop carriers, which are really tanks minus their their innards and turrets. And the Wasps, these are Bren carriers converted for flamethrowing. And the Crocodiles, this is a big edition of the Wasp, a flamethrowing tank. All these vehicles, as well as the supply vehicles, were lined up nose to tail, waiting to be called forward through the gaps of the minefield. By this time, the forward brigades had taken their objectives in the Siegfried Line, and Boche prisoners were beginning to come back. They were in pretty poor shape and didn't need much looking after. In fact, when a bunch of them came trudging down the muddy road without an escort and wanted to give themselves up, one of my platoon commanders, who was sitting on top of a kangaroo, just pointed backwards over his shoulder with his thumb and said, "Grosbeak." And the German said, "Ja, ja, Grosbeak," and shuffled off on their own. They knew where to go, because Grosbeak had been a rest centre for Siegfried Line troops until we moved in. Well, we pushed on in soaking rain, and when we got near to Cleve, I sent forward a platoon at first light in the morning to find out what was happening in the town. They got into the outskirts of the town, took up positions in a house, and sent back a runner to report the situation to me. On the way back, this chap was sniped at and hit in the upper arm and had to be carried back to my company headquarters. After he had made his official report, he was greatly concerned that his water bottle should be removed from his equipment and sent back to his platoon down in Cleve. I thought he was raving a bit and told him not to worry, and then had him taken to the regimental aid post. So off he went, still reminding us to send his water bottle back to the troops. I was a bit busy, and I'm afraid I forgot all about his water bottle. Anyway, although the boys might be short of water, they surely wouldn't be as short as all that. However, about an hour later, the company sergeant major came into headquarters and started to brew up some tea. He picked up the handiest water bottle he saw lying about and started pouring the contents into his mess tin. It was rum. So the wounded runner's concern was explained. He had been in charge of the platoon's ration and wanted it to get back to them. He sent it back, under fire. The men who took it were sniped at, but the rum got there safely. We followed it into Cleve pretty soon after, and about the first thing we saw there were two bulldozers clearing the streets of rubble. I had seen these vehicles the night before while we were clearing out some strong points covering the road into the town. There was quite a lot of shooting going on when the two bulldozers came rattling along the road. Marcio stopped them. Where are you going? He asked the driver. Cleves, sir, they answered. You can't go there. The roads are under fire. What kind of fire, they asked. Oh, small arms fire. Rifles, machine guns. You'll get shot at if you get on there. Any anti-tank guns, sir? No. Then, if you please, sir, we'll go on. You see, sir, our orders are to have the roads clear for the morning, and we're armoured. We'll get through all right. And get through they did, for as I said, there they were, sweeping the debris from the streets of Cleve when we came in the morning. After we had taken our part of the town, we were able to relax a bit and draw breath, and I took this opportunity to get my fellows together and let them know how the action was going. So I gathered them in the big room of a not-too-badly damaged house, and using the door as a blackboard, started to illustrate the action with a chalk-drawn map. While I was talking, I found the men were not paying attention. Their eyes kept straying to the floor, so I stopped talking and looked at the floor myself. The place was littered with rice marks, all of 5 marks value. You should have seen the dive when I gave them permission to pick them up. And this is as good a point as any to break off this story of the Royal Scots Fusiliers in Germany. The men are fit and in wonderful spirits.